Jesus said to the woman, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and do not sin again." Let's talk about mercy and judgment. There is confusion in the modern church about the relationship between mercy and judgment. Some people in the church think we are too judgmental and we talk too much about sin. They quote, for example, Luke 6, 36 and 37, which says, "Be merciful as your Father is merciful. Judge not, and you will not be judged." Some even quote Pope Francis, who regrettably said, "Who am I to judge?" They think we should talk more about God's mercy and less about God's judgment. But mercy and judgment go hand in hand. They are interdependent. You don't have one without the other. If there's no sin, why do we need mercy? There's no need for forgiveness if we've done nothing wrong. In the gospel story today, Jesus shows us how judgment and mercy are related. Now, the woman had been caught in the very act of adultery. There was no question about her guilt. And the prescribed punishment for her was death by stoning. I will refer you to a book, to a movie that came out perhaps 10 years ago called The Stoning of Soraya M. It's based on a true story that came out of Iran, and it is about the period in Iran immediately after the fall of the Shah and the coming of the Ayatollahs who governed with a very harsh Sharia law. But during that period, Iran, believe it or not, Iran, you may not remember this, but Iran was a very progressive country, a westernized country, where women were educated and had high degrees, and there were doctors and lawyers among women. The story of Soraya M. is a story about a woman, an Iranian woman, a Persian woman, who was an educated woman. She was married, she had children. Her husband, under the Ayatollahs, under Sharia law, her husband started having an affair and wanted to get rid of her. So he and one witness framed her and condemned her to stoning. And that's all I'm going to say. I guess you can get it on Netflix. I don't know where you can get it. But it's a very graphic portrayal of what it was like to stone somebody. You know, I never thought about what it's like to stone somebody. You know, the person lays down and they pile stones on them. But actually what they did is she was put in her wedding dress and buried in a hole with her arms in the hole. So she was buried up to here so she couldn't move and she just was there. And then starting with her sons, they stoned her, right? And then everybody, sons, husband, and then the whole place. It was a horrible, horrible, harrowing thing. So I just have to say that because I will never forget it. Stoning is a horrendous, heinous punishment. So the punishment for this woman's adultery was death by stoning. And the Pharisees thought they had finally trapped Jesus when they confronted him. Either they put him in an impossible situation, and either he must choose one or the other. Break Moses' law and be illegitimate, or uphold Moses' law and get in trouble with the Romans. But Jesus put the decision back on them when he said, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And St. John tells us, when they heard it, they went away, one by one, beginning with the eldest. I like that detail, because presumably the eldest were the ones that knew they had more sins on their conscience than anyone else. So they were out of there. And then St. John goes on to continue. Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. And think about that. That is like a rehearsal of Judgment Day, right? That's like a rehearsal of a soul standing before the judgment seat of God, face to face with the only one who can righteously, legitimately condemn her to death. And Jesus looked at her and said, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and do not sin again. Go and don't do it again." Now, so many times when I was a United Methodist pastor, people ended the story after, "Neither do I condemn you," believe it or not, and they left off that critical last statement, "Go and do not sin again." See, Jesus did not condemn the woman, but he did judge her. He did judge her. He called her adultery for what it was, sin, clearly breaking the God's law, and he clearly commanded her to stop doing it. Jesus showed mercy, but he spoke the truth. And while Jesus did not condemn the woman, guess what? God's truth did. She stood condemned, not before Jesus, but before the Word of God, God's truth. Adultery is a sin. It's a clear breaking of God's law. It destroys marriages and families. We can't accept it. And it would be neither truthful nor merciful for Jesus to let the woman go away without confronting her. Sadly, we live in a world today that refuses to confront people about sin. It's a world, in fact, that trivializes sin, even inside the church. And in my opinion, the trivialization of sin is one of the biggest problems in the church today. Because sin is measured against God's law. By definition, sin is an offense against God's law. And when sin is trivialized, think about it, God is trivialized. When sin is trivialized, God's law is trivialized, and ultimately God himself is trivialized, and we end up functionally atheists. And that's the state of the world we live in today, an atheistic world, rejecting God and his law. But the church, in her wisdom, holds judgment and mercy together. And I want to point out, I just noticed that this week, even in its liturgical calendar, the church holds together judgment and mercy. So let's think about it. Today is Passion Sunday. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and that begins Holy Week, which culminates in Good Friday, on which day Jesus died for what? For our sins. And then there's Easter Sunday, on which day Jesus rose from the dead. And then the following Sunday is what? Divine Mercy Sunday. I hadn't noticed that before. But we are at one end of a journey through the passion, death, and resurrection of Jesus, and at the other end of which is Divine Mercy Sunday. See how the church in its wisdom brings those together? We don't get to Divine Mercy without passing through the Triduum. And that reminds us that God's mercy was purchased with the blood of Jesus shed on the cross for our sins. That was the price of our salvation. And the book of Hebrews asks rhetorically, chapter 2, verse 3, how shall we escape if we neglect such a great salvation? So we can't escape judgment. When Jesus revealed the divine mercy to St. Faustina, his revelation came with a warning. In her diary, she records that he said, "Before I come as a just judge, I first open wide the door of my mercy. He who refuses to pass through the door of my mercy must pass through the door of my justice." So what does that justice look like? Well, Fatima's been in the news lately. Our Lady revealed a vision of hell to the three seers, the three children, the youngest of which was 6 or 7, about what hell looks like, and it was horrendous. She didn't do that to terrify them. She did that to warn us. But it's also recorded in Scripture, in Hebrews, chapter 10, starting in verse 26. What happens to us if we refuse God's mercy and go on sinning? This is what happens to us. If we go on sinning deliberately after receiving the knowledge of the truth, there no longer remains a sacrifice for sins, but a fearful expectation of judgment and a fury of fire that will consume the adversaries. Anyone who has set aside the law of Moses dies without mercy on the evidence of 2 or 3 witnesses. How much worse punishment do you think will be deserved by the one who has spurned the Son of God and has profaned the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has outraged the Spirit of grace? For we know him who said, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay." And again, "The Lord will judge his people." It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. So in conclusion, it's our human nature to sin. We're fallen. It's also our human nature to try to make excuses for sin or to trivialize it. We mistakenly think God in his mercy will let us off the hook. Story today shows us, and other places, other stories, Jesus forgave sinners, but he never let them off the hook. He was always clear and honest with them, as he was with the woman caught in adultery. "Has no one condemned you? Then neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." Go and sin no more. That's spoken to us, too. Because the day will come for all of us when we meet God face to face. And he asks us, to give an account for the way we've lived our lives. We are now in the fifth week of Lent. Lent is a time of reflection, of prayer, of repentance, and preparation for the great mystery of Easter. It's a season to make our souls right with the Lord, to get right with the Lord. It's time to examine our consciences and make a trip to the confessional. Just before we entered for Mass, Father Al said, "Sorry I'm late, there were a lot of confessions today." And I thought, good. Good. Lent is a time to repent and cast ourselves on the mercy of God. God is merciful. But God's mercy can never be separated from God's truth. Judgment and mercy go hand in hand. You don't have one without the other. If there's no sin, why do we need mercy? Let me close now with one last scripture that sums up today's message. It's from Romans 11. "Behold then, the kindness and severity of God. To those who fell, severity. But to you, God's kindness. If you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off." In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.